करो स्टार्ट। गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू। एट द वेरी आउटसेट आई डॉक्टर विवेक श्रीवास्तव ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ लाइफ साइंस एसोसिएशन ऑफ दयानंद कॉलेज हिसार वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस नेशनल वेबिनार ऑन इम्यूनो मॉड्यूलेटरी इफेक्ट्स ऑफ एंटी ऑक्सीडेंट्स इन कॉम्बैटिंग COVID-19। आई वेलकम द की डेलिब्रेशन ऑफ द डे प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर आर के सलार Dean Faculty of Life Sciences, Chaudhary Devilal University, Sirsa. I also welcome Dr. Vikramjit Singh, Principal Dayanand College, Hisar, and the patron of this webinar. I welcome all the delegates, participants of this webinar from different parts of the country. I welcome the organizing secretary of the webinar and in charge Life Science Association, Dr. Chavi Mangala, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, Dayanand College, Hisar, Dr. Aditya Kumar and Dr. Hemant Sharma, co-conveners of this webinar, and both are Assistant Professor in Botany in Dayanand College, Hisar. I also welcome various members of the organizing committee, Dr. Raj Rani, Dr. Kanchan, Dr. Suman Bala, Dr. Minashini Jindal, श्री सचिन मेहरा श्री मनोज बिंदल मिसेस उर्वशी श्री देवराज श्री सुशील राजपाल इन दिस वेबिनार। डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, ऑल ऑफ अस आर वेरी फेमिलियर विद दिस COVID-19। नाउ ह्यूमन लाइफ हैज नेवर बीन मोर थ्रेटेंड ग्लोबली आफ्टर द सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर एज इज डन टूडे। इट हैज एनवलप्ड डोमेस्टिक सोशल finance, educational, creative, and also health issues of life, leaving everyone in a lurch. The outbreak of COVID-19 disease is spreading rapidly, and the World Health Organization declared it a public health emergency of international concern. So considering the current pandemic of COVID-19, where no effective preventive or curative medicine is available, a healthy immune system is one of the most important weapon to fight against the disease. Recent clinical trials have found that antioxidants supplementation can significantly improve the immune response of the human body. Antioxidants, nutrients in our diet like vitamin C, vitamin E, beta carotene, zinc, copper, iron, etc., can improve the immune system and protect against infections. These immunomodulators can be used as preventive or therapeutic agents. Therefore, selection of antioxidants therapy, considering its immunomodulatory effect, can be a boon in reducing treatment failure and adverse health effects due to coronavirus. Considering the importance of these antioxidants, current webinar is focused and Life Science Association of the Dayanand College Hisar is trying to put some light on these immunomodulators through this webinar. Dear participants, without taking much time, I welcome the key deliberation of today, Professor Dr. R. K. Salar. Professor Dr. R. K. Salar is presently working as Professor and Chairperson, Department of Biotechnology and Dean Faculty of Life Sciences, Chaudhary Devilal University, Sirsa. Professor Salar has an excellent and remarkable experience in teaching and research in the field of microbial biotechnology, enzyme technology, and fungal biotechnology. He has 22 years of research and 18 years of teaching experience. He did his MSc, MPhil and PhD from Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra, and postdoctoral research from Slovak University of Technology, Slovakia. Dr. R. K. Salar has published nearly 100 research papers attended 31 national and international workshops and conferences, and also organized 4 national and international level workshop as convener or organizing secretary. He has published 4 books as an author, out of which 3 books are published by Springer Germany and Springer Singapore, and 1 book by CRC Press Taylor and Francis. Dr. Salar has guided 33 MSc students for his research projects, 15 MPhil and 12 PhD students for their research work. He is member of many research professional bodies like Life Member of Association of Microbiologists of India, Life Member of Mycological Society of India, Member Society, Haryana State Council of Science and Technology, Member Board of Studies of various universities, and Member Institutional Biological Safety Committee, Chaudhary Devilal University, Sirsa. He is a reviewer of prestigious research journals like Journal of Basic Microbiology, Germany, African Journal of Microbiology Research, Africa, Annals of Applied Biology, Germany, Frontiers of Life Science, Taylor and Francis, Journal of Food Measurement and Characterization, Springer, Resource Efficient Technologies, Elsevier, and British Journal of Pharmacology and Toxicology, UK. He has received awards and honors also, like he has received Caxet Award from Saudi Arabia for best research paper published in 2013 in biotechnology, and a cash award of $5,000 and medal and citation. Awarded postdoctoral fellowship from Ministry of Education, Republic of Slovakia. Awarded grant of Government of Japan to attend 10th International Congress for Culture Collection at Tsukuba, Japan. Awarded travel grant by Department of Science and Technology, Ministry of Technology, to attend 7th International Microbiology Conference at Oslo, Norway. Professor Salar visited countries like Japan, Slovakia, Austria, Hungary, Norway for his research assignments, and delivered an invited lecture on botanical and biopesticides at National Institute of Advanced Industrial Science and Technology, Tsukuba, Japan. As his administrative Professor R.K. Salar served on key administrative positions in the university, served as professor in charge of Department of Biotechnology from 2005 to 2007, chairperson of the department from 2007 to 2008 and 2011 to 2014, Dean Faculty of Life Science, Sirsa, Chaudhary Devilal University, Sirsa, 2007-2008, and from 2017 till date, he is serving as Dean Faculty of Life Sciences. He has also served as State Public Information Officer of University from 2011 to 2013. Dr. Salar, I am extremely thankful to you for giving us time from your busy schedule, and welcome you once again to share your views on this topic. Before we start, there is an announcement for the participants that if there are questions or queries, please do not interrupt the speaker between the presentation. The queries will be discussed after the presentation. Thank you very much. Dr. Salar, I request you to please start your presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Vivek Srivastava, for the very long introduction. So, not taking much time, I would like to go directly to share the today's presentation. So is it visible,
Dr. Vivek? Yes, it's visible, Laksab, it's visible.
Is it visible? And
yes,
am I audible to everyone?
Yes, you are audible, Laksab.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. So at the outset, I would like to thank the organizing committee of the DN College Hisar for giving me an opportunity to speak to the lovely audience. I'm also thankful to the principal of the college for inviting me for delivering this talk. And I would like to share, as Dr. Srivastava has already shared this information, that each and every participant should keep their mic on mute mode because if you keep it on, then it will, the sound will echo. So therefore, you will not be able to hear. So going into details of the today's lecture. So first of all, I would like to say that we are living in a very, you know, frightened environment today. And each and every person today is frightened to go out and to live like he was living before this disease. So this disease has devastated the economies of several countries, not several, but the whole world is affected by this disease. And it is very devastating disease, and God knows that whether we will be able to combat this disease or whether we will be able to overcome this disease in the time to come. Surely we are hopeful and optimistic that we will be able to you know, overcome this disease in the time to come. And so there are, you know, several ways by which we can, you know, ward off this disease. And this is a very serious kind of disease which has affected more than, you know, 10 million people all around the world as of date, and about 500,000 of people have died because of this disease. So this is very devastating and you know, very frustrating to everyone. So as far as today's lecture is concerned, I would like to speak on the immunomodulatory effect of antioxidants, because as you know that as of now we don't have any, you know, treatment for this disease which we can, you know, be sure that by which we can, you know, treat this disease or we can, you know, ward off this disease. So the only and only you know, option we have is that those who are fit, those who have, you know, their immune system is very strong, they are able to ward off this disease. And the people who have, you know, compromised immunity, the people who have lower immunity, and this lower immunity may be because of certain comorbidities, because of certain, you know, cancers, diabetes, high blood pressure, or similar kind of diseases. So the people who have such kind of diseases, they are at very high risk of this disease, by to contract this disease. So this is very, you know, devastating disease. Before going into details, let us you know, consider first the concept of you know, immunity. The concept of immunity is like you know, that immunity is the ability of any person or any individual to ward off the disease. Different people, say like you have two people, they may be, one may be immune to a particular kind of disease and the other may be susceptible. So susceptibility is that those person who can, you know, easily contract the disease, so they are susceptible. And those who can ward off this, the disease, they are, you know, immune. Now how this immunity, you know, works? Immunity basically is, you know, of two types. You have innate immunity and you have adaptive immunity or acquired immunity. So innate immunity is the defense against any pathogen. So the innate immunity, basically a child receives from its parents. So that is innate immunity. And then we have the adaptive immunity. And adaptive immunity basically is the immunity or, you know, resistance to the disease. I'm just, you know, leaving these, you know, thumbnails. So, okay. So we have adaptive immunity. So immunity, that is, that is acquired during the lifetime of an individual. Say you are infected with some pathogen and your body recognize that pathogen and produces certain antibodies against that pathogen. And once that immunity is developed, once those antibodies they are developed, then those antibodies, they can be they can make you immune for the second time infection about from that particular pathogen. So that is basically the adaptive immunity. So as I told you that innate immunity is received from the parents by the child, and the innate immunity basically it encompasses the first line of defense and the second line of defense. The first line of defense is basically your skin, your intact skin, your mucous membranes and their secretions, and the normal microbiota. That means the normal microflora which is present in your gut, which is present in your intestine or other body parts. So normal microbiota that also ward off certain pathogens which cannot be able to enter into your body. So that is the first line of defense. The second line of defense is basically which is present in your blood, say like phagocytes such as neutrophils, eosinophils, dendritic cells, macrophages. So then even say for example if some antigen enters your body, then there is a response by the body, and that may be in the form of fever, in the form of inflammation. So that if the if antigen enters into the body and if there is no inflammation or no fever, that means your body is not responding to the antigen. So inflammation and fever, this denotes that your body is acting against that antigen. There are certain antimicrobial substances which can act as second line of defense against the pathogens. Then you have the acquired or adaptive immunity. That is the third line of defense. And that is basically, say like in childhood, we have received so many kind of vaccines. So those vaccines, they are present in the form of antibodies in our body, and these antibodies, they can recognize the particular kind of the pathogen, and that pathogen is warded off immediately when it enters into the body. So that is adaptive immunity. So I'm not able to clear this bar. Dr. Vivek.
Hello.
Okay. I have removed it now. Okay. So because this bar is coming, this bar is coming.
Except there is no such kind of bar on the screen, please, in our screen.
I'm able to see it like mute, stop video and the participants, all that. So that is there. So that is, hindering my vision to the slides. I don't know how to remove it.
I think it's okay, Dr. Sam, now. Hello?
It is coming there. Okay. So going into details, further details of the concept of immunity. So we have host, the host has toll-like receptors, which are known as TLRs. These are attached to pathogen-associated molecule molecular patterns, which are basically known as PMPs. So these TLRs, they induce cytokines, and these cytokines regulate the intensity and duration of the immune response. You might have heard that lot of, you know, vaccines against coronavirus disease, they are being developed all over the world. And some says that one vaccine will work for 1 year or another vaccine will work for 2 years. So it is basically the cytokine response which, you know, regulate the intensity and the duration of that particular antibodies. So as I told you about the innate immunity, so physical factors, they are there. Say like you have skin, you have epidermis. Epidermis consists of tightly packed cells with the keratin, which is a, you know, protective protein. So this is the first line of defense. Mucous membranes are there. Mucus basically, what, you know, mucus does is that it traps the microbes. And in our, you know, gut, you have, you know, ciliary escalators. Ciliary, you know, cilias are there. And these cilia, they transport microbes trapped in mucus away from the lungs. So this is the basic, you know, role of the mucous membranes and the ciliary, you know, escalators. So this is basically a depiction of the surface of the skin. You have got, I'm not able to, you know, see my screen, Vivek.
Sir, we are able to see it.
Okay, you are able to see, but you know, there is a bar which is, you know, coming frequently on my screen.
And yes, sir, there is no bar on the, there is no bar on our screen, sir.
You don't have,
no, but sir, there is no bar on our screen. We are able to see the full screen of yours.
Full screen.
You are able to see, but I am not able to see the screen, and that hinders the presentation basically. I don't know how to, you know, remove it.
So on our side, anyway, the screen is visible.
Okay, okay.
There is no.
So anyway, so we have, you know, this skin, and this upper part is the epidermis. And in the uppermost part, we have, you know, keratin. And this keratin, as I told you, that it is a protein which basically, you know, ward off the microorganisms. And this is the ciliated epithelium, which, you know, which is there in your mucous membranes in the, you know, gut. And here you can see the cilia, these long thread-like structures. These are the cilia, which can, you know, trap the bacillus pertussis. Say, for example, this is one of the example of a pathogen. So the red ones, these are the bacillus cells which are trapped by the cilia, and they are, you know, basically, you know, warded off after some time. Then this is again the computer enhanced, you know, structures of the ciliary escalators. And you can see the trapped particles in mucus. You can see the cilia. You can see the goblet cells and ciliated cells. So this is basic, you know, the innate immunity structure. Then what is basically immunodeficiency? So this immunodeficiency, why, you know, immunity is compromised? Immunity basically is, you know, compromised because of two reasons. One can be, you know, congenial. Congenial is because of certain defective genes which are, you know, there in a person or a human being. So congenial this deficiency of immunity is due to defective or missing genes. And then you have acquired deficiency. The acquired deficiency is basically developed during lifetime of an individual. And this may be due to intake of certain drugs, it may be because of the cancer disease, it may be because of oxidative stress and infections. Infection by pathogens, infection by bacteria, infection by viruses. So all these infections, diseases, drugs, and oxidative stress, they contribute to, you know, acquired deficiency of the immune system. So the in all of these, oxidative stress that plays an important role in lowering the immunity. Say oxygen basically it is
So screen is visible. Full.
It is visible to you, but a bar is coming on the top of my slides, which is, you know, hiding the slide to me.
मनोज जी कुछ किया जा सकता है क्या मनोज जी इसको चेक करने के बाद
You know, because I will not be able to communicate efficiently, because if, you know, what I wanted to communicate, that will be, you know, very difficult. So I don't know how to.
So it is very clear on YouTube also. All the slides are visible on the YouTube.
These are visible, but this bar is there.
Vivek ji, it's not visible to the doctor. It is visible for us, but not visible to doctor.
Okay, sir. We are trying. देखते हैं.
नहीं सर, कुछ पता नहीं लग रहा. ठीक चल रहा है सर.
Either it comes on the top, or it comes. Okay, I can manage that. I will bring it first on the downside and then on the upside. That I can manage. Okay, Vivek, there is no problem now.
Okay.
So, as I told you, that oxidative stress is a very important, you know, phenomena in every human being. So, oxygen basically it is a matter of life and death. Without oxygen, we cannot survive, and with oxygen, that the oxygen can also play havoc with, you know, our life. So, you must have, you know, heard that there are certain people who are actually, you know, 60 years old or 65 years old, but they look very young. And similarly, there are certain people who are 35 or 40, but they look like 60. So that is there. So it is because of, you know, certain oxidative stress. And as we, you know, age, our breathing capacity declines around 40%. Say, like, if we age from, you know, 20 to 70 years, so there is a 40% decline in our breathing capacity. And because of this decline, there is a, you know, oxidative stress in our body. And this oxidative stress is responsible for several kind of the oxygen species, which basically are, you know, free radicals. And these free radicals, they are responsible for causing so many kind of diseases, be it, you know, diabetes, be it cancer, be it, you know, cardiovascular diseases or arthritis, whatever it is. So free radicals, these are basically, you know, being generated in our body. So if this, you know, free radicals or the reactive oxygen species, which basically we call as ROS, if they are allowed to run in our body, if they are allowed to be there in our body, then they can damage our DNA, which basically kill the cells, or the cells may turn out to be cancerous. They may damage, you know, lipids, which may cause damage to the membranes. They may cause damage proteins, which may cause, you know, inactivation of the enzymes. So all these effects, they will result in, you know, serious diseases. So what I was talking about is that the free radicals. So free radicals basically is a molecule. It may be an oxygen species, it may be a nitrogen species. So it is a molecule with one or more unpaired electron in its outer shell. That is basically known as a free radical. And these free radicals, they are formed from molecules via the breakage of a chemical bond such that each fragment keep one electron, and by cleavage of a radical to give another radical, and also via redox reactions. So these free radicals, they, as I told you, they are in the form of, you know, oxygen species or in the form of nitrogen species. And there are several types of free radicals. And these free radicals, they basically damage membranes, cellular membranes, they damage DNA, they damage enzymes, and ultimately they cause oxidative stress. Now, there are two types of the reactive species. It is oxygen and nitrogen. Reactive oxygen species, which is known as ROS, and reactive nitrogen species, which is known as RNS. So under severe oxidative stress, ROS and free radicals, they are formed. And these reactive oxygen species, they include in order of their, you know, increasing reduction, they are singlet oxygens, they may be superoxide radicals, they may be hydrogen peroxide radicals, they may be, you know, hydroxyl radicals. And similarly, you have, you know, nitrogen species, reactive nitrogen species, they include nitric oxide radicals, nitrogen dioxide radicals. So at low concentration, at low concentration or a moderate level, reactive oxygen species and reactive nitrogen species, they you know, exert beneficial effect to the body on cellular response and immune function. But at a very high concentration, they generate oxidative stress, which I have already told you. And this oxidative stress is a deleterious process that can damage all cell structures, and it can lead to several types of diseases, which I have already told you, like, you know, cancer. It may result in, you know, the cardiovascular diseases, the, you know, arthritis, diabetes, or whatever, whatever you name. So most of the diseases, they are caused by the oxidative stress in our body. So as far as the sources of the free radicals are concerned, basically, during our metabolism, whatever we are doing day and night, so our body is metabolizing. And the, you know, compounds or whatever is there, whatever the food is there in our body, so that is being metabolized by our body. And during the normal cell metabolism, these free radicals, they are normally produced. That is basically known as in situ production of the free radicals. So our body has got sufficient, you know, negating mechanism by which these free radicals, the effect of these free radicals can be minimized. Similarly, there are certain metals, when they are present in blood, they catalyze free radical production. Say, for example, if you have much of iron in your blood, and if, you know, hydrogen peroxide is there, then it can result in production of hydroxyl radicals. Similarly, cigarette smoking, that is also linked to the production of the free radicals. Similarly, alcohol consumption, certain radiations, environmental pollution. So these are all related to the formation of free radicals. And these free radicals, they, you know, cause many type of diseases. Similarly, you have got, you know, synthetic drugs. Synthetic drugs, they are also, you know, causing the production of free radicals. And nowadays, the synthetic drugs, they are major source of free radicals. Coming to the this present situation through which all of us are facing, and that is COVID-19. Basically, many of the people, they do not know what is COVID. COVID is basically the coronavirus disease, and 19 is the 2019 when this disease appeared in Wuhan, China. This virus, coronavirus, it belongs to coronaviridae family, and there are several coronaviruses which already exist. This particular virus is not known to us, and its genomic structure is quite different from those which are already known to man. So this is this coronavirus, basically the name comes from the crown, like its shape is, you know, somewhat spherical with you know, spikes on its surface which looks like a crown, and that's why the name corona. So it has got a single stranded RNA and the, you know, protein envelope, and these proteins, basically they are in the form of spikes. Okay, so other, you know, coronaviruses which were, you know, say like you have SARS is also a coronavirus, which you know, that pandemic came in, you know, 2002, SARS pandemic. But that, you know, coronavirus had little you know, spikes, and that because of those little spikes, it was not able to, you know, attach to the respiratory system, and the transmission of that virus was, you know, very less. But this coronavirus, it has got, you know, plenty of spikes, protein spikes, which help this virus in attaching to the, you know, respiratory system, the gut or the nose, whatever it is. So this is basically a coronavirus, and it is technically it is known as SARS-CoV-2. So this is the basic structure you can see. This is this is just you know, diagrammatic presentation. And this virus, as I told you, that it belong to coronaviridae family. Now, if you see, normally the coronaviruses, they are, you know, animal viruses. They do not come to human beings, but at certain times they cross this, you know, species barrier, and interspecies transmission is you know, very common. Interspecies transmission, say like among bats, avians, the interspecies transmission was common. But interspecies transmission is not very common, and this, because of this, you know, intraspecies transmission, this coronavirus has jumped from, it is, you know, believed that it has come from the bats, so from bats to human beings, and that is basically known as you know, zoonotic transmission. And this, once this zoonotic transmission occurs, then the next host becomes its, you know, normal host. Now, this influenza virus, basically these are, you know, causing diseases and, you know, causing influenza-like symptoms, severe acute respiratory syndrome. So H1N1 virus, there was a similar kind of pandemic in around 100 years back. In 1918, there was H1N1, you know, pandemic, which was basically from avian gene pool. And then there was another, you know, pandemic, as I told you, that was SARS, MERS, all these, you know, pandemics, they came. And that is basically all these, you know, viruses, basically they belong to the coronavirus family. So so you have, you know, two faces of this virus. Now you can see one is, you know, happy face, and another is, you know, something which is, you know, very frightening to all human beings. On one side you can see, this is basically a cartoon which I picked up for you. On one side, on the greener side, you can see that because of this virus, the nature is curing. There is reduction, dramatic reduction in pollution. All animals, they can move freely. You might have seen all this happening on your television. And on the other side, on the red side, you can see that this virus has, you know, caused havoc with human life. And as I told you, that about 500,000 of people, they have already died within a span of, you know, 3 to 4 months. Only, you know, 500,000 people within 3 to 4 months. And as some of the scientists say, that this virus is not going anywhere. This will stay here. It is a permanent guest and it will not go anywhere. So we have to, you know, we have to learn how to live with this virus. As of now, we don't have any, you know, any therapeutic treatment for this virus. Only hit and trial are there. Only certain, you know, therapeutic medicines, they are being tried. There is no vaccine as of now. So only what we can do is, we can, you know, ward off this virus with change in our habit. So how we can combat this virus, basically, that is the question. And further focus will be on prophylaxis. Prophylaxis is, that is, prevention. That is, you know, prevention. You might have heard about that prevention is better than cure. So combating COVID-19, there are two, you know, strategies which can be there. One is the non-pharmaceutical intervention by which we can, you know, reduce infection by 90%. And that is hand washing, cough and sneeze etiquettes, and, you know, physical distancing, social distancing. So by following all this, we can reduce the infection rate. If all human beings on earth, they follow these, you know, non-pharmaceutical intervention, we will be able to, you know, control this virus. We will be able to manage this virus. Although it's difficult to control this virus, but we will be able to manage this virus. So with non-pharmaceutical interventions like hand washing, cough and sneeze etiquette, social distancing, we'll be able to, up to 90% we'll be able to control this. Then we have the pharmaceutical interventions. In pharmaceutical interventions, we have prophylaxis. Prophylaxis means the, you know, prevention of the disease. How we can, you know, prevent. One of the prevention is non-pharmaceutical intervention, that we are not, you know, we are not able to contract this disease. And then other is, you know, the prophylaxis, that is, you know, increasing your immunity. That is very important. And that is basically the discussion, the point of discussion in every walk of life today, all over the world, not only in India, but all over the world. Immunity is being discussed today at a, you know, very, you know, high point. So prophylaxis is there. Then therapeutic is basically, you know, when you have contracted the disease and you can you know, treat that disease. That is therapeutic. So we at you know, this point of time, we don't have any therapeutic, but there are certain, you know, drugs which are being, you know, tried by several you know, hospitals, several you know, medical practitioners. They are trying this, you know, each and every day. You find that one of the hospital has tried this drug, the other hospital has tried this drug. So it is basically hit and trial that is going on with the drugs. So, but if your immune system is very, you know, strong, you have also seen that most people who are falling prey to this virus, they are either, they either have some comorbidity, that means they have some disease, hypertension, or they have diabetes, or they are, you know, cancer patients, or some other, you know, kind of morbidity is there. So those people, they are dying. But the younger people, those who are below 50 or below 60 even, they have, you know, quite improved you know, immunity. They have quite, you know, strong immunity. And as I told you in the very beginning, that when you age from, you know, 20 to 70, so after, you know, 60, your immunity, that declines. And when your immunity declines, then there are, you know, chances of contracting this disease. So that is that we have to, you know, focus now. So prophylaxis is basically the prevention, how we can, you know, prevent this disease. And that is, you know, the discussion of today's topic, immunomodulation. Immunomodulation is basically, although there are certain, you know, drugs which can be used as immunomodulators that can improve our immunity. So immunomodulation, that, you know, consists of all therapeutic interventions aimed at modifying the immune system. We can modify the immune system, we can make our immune system strong. Similarly, increasing the immune response, augmentation of the immune response is desirable to prevent infection in states of immunodeficiency. So once, you know, immune deficiency is there, then our immune response can be augmented with the help of certain, as I told you, with the help of certain, you know, methods, like we'll be discussing it, you know, later in this lecture, the antioxidants. So we can, you know, augment the immune response, and the deficiency can be, you know, immunity can be enhanced to fight the established infections. Then to prevent infections, vaccination is the most, you know, important and effective immunomodulatory technique. That is only the technique which can modulate your immune system. And new tools to manipulate the response to vaccine involve the use of cytokines, viral vectors, and even the naked DNA that can be, you know, used. So now what is the option before us? When we don't have any, you know, drug, we don't have any vaccine, what is the option? The option is that the nutraceuticals or the functional foods. Now, what are nutraceuticals? Nutraceuticals, basically, if you see, if you go into history, Greek physician Hippocrates, who is also known as the father of medicine, he said several centuries ago that let food be your medicine. You eat food like your medicine. And you choose your food in such a manner that it gives you, you know, pharmaceutical health. So basically, let food be your medicine. So the philosophy behind this statement was the focus on prevention. How we can, you know, prevent the disease? That is the basic focus. So this nutraceutical term it has, you know, gained a very, you know, a great importance in the recent times. And this nutraceutical term for you, I would like to say that, share with you that this nutraceutical term, it was coined by Stephen D. Felice in 1989. He was a founder chairman of the FIM, that is Foundation of Innovative Medicine in New Jersey. So the nutraceutical term was coined by combining nutrition and pharmaceutical. You can see it, right? So other terms used in this context, they are dietary supplements. These days, in India, there is not, it is not very much common, but also if you go to some, you know, bigger cities, these, you know, dietary supplements, functional foods or nutraceuticals, they are available in supermarkets. So all these, you know, nutraceuticals, they are available in India, they are available, but in other countries, but in developed countries, say like if you go to Canada, if you go to Japan, if you go to US, nutraceuticals or the dietary supplements, they are part of their food. They regularly take these nutraceuticals, particularly the old people. So they are, you know, frequently taking these nutraceuticals, and I'll come to, you know, this, you know, the business about this nutraceutical later in this lecture. So, but, you know, Japan has most aged population in the world. They have most aged population. And that is also, you know, burden on the government. So these aged person, they are, you know, taking lot of nutraceuticals. There is a lot of demand of these nutraceuticals. Now, so should we be ready to fight this, the attack of the free radical, which I, you know, told you earlier? So this is just a cartoon depiction of the antioxidants, the pro-oxidants, they are put in jail because of the antioxidants. So where do you find these antioxidants? You find these antioxidants in the form of phenolic compounds, maybe the polyphenols, maybe the flavonoids. The antioxidants, they are present in, you know, fruits, in vegetables, in whole grains. Whole grains, it is very important these days. Whole grain consumption has gained a lot of momentum these days because of the, you know, diminishing immunity in today's world. Industrial antioxidants, they are also available. So if you go to, you know, these you know, antioxidants, they are present in fruits and vegetables. All, you know, colored fruits and colored vegetables, they are, you know, rich source of antioxidants, antioxidant compounds. And these may be in, you know, the bioactive compounds, they may be the polyphenols, they may be phytosterols, carotenoids, tocopherols, tocotrienols, organosulfurs, fibers, and other, you know, prebiotics. These may be there. The bioactive compounds are in these forms. So phenolic compounds, basically, they act as antioxidants. And there are about 4,000 phenolic compounds, such as phenolic acid, flavonoid, proanthocyanin. They have been obtained from plants. The plants, they are rich source of the antioxidants. And a lot of, you know, interest has been gained recently in having a healthy diet. And this healthy diet is stimulating the innovative development of novel products with antioxidant ability in the food industry. Phytochemicals, they act as the main source of antioxidants in plants, right? So polyphenols, basically they contain one or more benzene rings along with varying number of hydroxyl, carbonyl and carboxyl groups. They are found conjugated with one or more sugar residues. The flavonoids, they are most common type of polyphenols. Similarly, the catechins, Thiobrindins and theophylavins, isoflavins, they are also important polyphenols, and all these polyphenols, they are widely distributed in plant world. So these are, you know, some structures of the phenolic acids, like cumaric acid, paracumaric acid, caffeic acid, ferulic acid, gallic acid, protocatechoic acid. So all these phenolic compounds, the mechanism as of the mechanism is, as far as mechanism is concerned, the phenolic compounds, they neutralize the effect of the free radicals, they improve urinary tract health, they get bound to toxins or carcinogens in the intestine tract, and they also prevent their absorption, that is absorption of the free radicals. Now, how these free radicals, they work? What is the mechanism of action of these free radicals? You can see, just this is a depiction of the mechanism of action. You have a, on the left side, you have a free radical, the number one cause of skin aging. Because of, if you see, as we age, there is, wrinkles in our skin. And these wrinkles, they are basically, how these wrinkles, they are formed. These are formed because of the free radicals. The free radicals, they are generated externally from sunlight, pollution, or cellular metabolism. And these free radicals, they basically destroy collagen network, the collagen fibers, which the collagen fiber, which, binds the cells together. So once these, that collagen network is loosened, then the cells become loose, and the ultimately the skin falls into gaps, creating a lot of, wrinkles in the body. On the other hand, if you see, if you have an antioxidant firewall, that is antioxidant, that is, number one squanger. Antioxidants, they are number one squanger of free radicals. So these antioxidants act like a sponge to soak the free radicals, and these firewalls, they neutralize free radicals and protect the collagen network. The collagen network is not loosened, and there is, smaller wrinkles, they are formed as collagen is produced using lot of industrial antioxidants are there. You might have seen that if one goes to some skincare facility, some injections, they are given near the eyes, where you have most of wrinkles. So that is retinol is given. So that wrinkles fade because of this retinol. It squench all those free radicals. So which antioxidants, they are especially good for our immune function? We have a lot of antioxidants, but regularly we are taking these antioxidants, and that's why most of the vegetarian people, they basically have they are able to ward off the diseases more frequently as compared to the non-vegetarians. So the vegetable foods, or whatever you have, the fruits or the grains, cereals, all these, they have antioxidants. But sometimes these antioxidants, they are not fully available, they are not fully absorbable in our body. They sometimes remain bound where they are. All right, so there are several types of antioxidants which are available. Like you have vitamin C. This is one of the, everyone knows that vitamin C is very important, and even if you consume vitamin C, you are able to ward off the common cold or influenza. That can be warded off very easily if you take vitamin C is basically ascorbic acid, which is, you know, present in citrus fruits, in peppers, strawberries, broccoli, and tomatoes. So all these fruits and vegetables, they contain vitamin C. And I think all, you know, we all are, you know, consuming these fruits and vegetables. But there is a lot of junk which is not, you know, able to, you know, take these fruits or vegetables. All right. So they have the, you know, compromised immunity. And similarly, you have vitamin E. Vitamin E is basically obtained from sunflower seeds, almonds, hazelnuts, pine nuts, avocado, salmon, mangoes. So they are rich source of vitamin E. Similarly, you have beta carotene. Beta carotene is, you know, present in, you know, carrots, sweet potatoes, squash, red and yellow peppers, apricots, etc. So similarly, you have, you know, flavonoids. Flavonoids. Flavonoids basically they are obtained from, and there is, you know, they are present in plenty in strawberries, blackberries, raspberries, bananas, fava beans, onion, celery, artichokes, apples, pears, walnuts, soybean. So all these, you know, fruits and vegetables, they contain, you know, most flavonoids. Then you have selenium. Selenium is very important. Selenium is also available in pure form in say, like some of the homeopathic, you know, medicine. They are available there. So, but it is, you know, present in plenty in nuts, in fish, in ham, in pork, turkey, eggs, brown rice, cottage cheese, mushrooms. Mushrooms, they are, you know, very rich source of selenium. Then you have zinc. Zinc is present in meat, shellfish, legumes, seeds, nuts, dairy, food, eggs, whole grains. Whole grains, they are, you know, rich source of this antioxidant. Then you have omega-3 fatty acids, omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. These are very important. And they are basically present in certain fishes like fat fish, salmon fish, tuna, halibut, sardines, pollock. In algae, they are also present. In walnut, they are present. Nut oils, flax seeds, they contain, you know, lot of omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. So these, you know, plant sources, they are very important and credible source of antioxidants. And we must consume all these named plants and vegetables. So some of the recent studies have shown that even this, this was one of our paper. We worked on Vidania somnifera when I was in Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, 20 years back. So we started work on Vidania somnifera, and we isolated two important components, vidanolides and vidaferrin. Now these vidanolides and vidaferrin, basically I started this work, and then it was taken up by one of my colleague there, Dr. Pratapati. He took that work, and now he has also, you know, he has collaborated with one of the lab in Japan, AIST, and Dr. Renu Vadva and Dr. Sunil Kohl. I also visited that lab, their lab, and at that time I was working on this, but later I left this. And then there is a, you know, project which is taken by IIT Delhi. And this IIT Delhi, in collaboration with AIST, Dr. Sunil's lab, they have developed a certain, you know, they have found certain interesting results with Vidania somnifera. That is ashwagandha. I think everyone knows about ashwagandha. So that is Vidania somnifera. So this is the study which is, you know, carried out. This is a very recent study, just 1 month back. and they have, you know, worked like they have isolated certain vidanon and cap. So they formed a formulation of ashwagandha and propolis. This ashwagandha and propolis is required, is you know, able to you know, put a break on the replication of the protein of this virus, SARS-CoV-2 virus. So vidanon is also predicted to block the cell membrane receptor, which is required for entry of virus into the cell, entry of this virus into into our, you know, respiratory system. So if this, you know, vidanon is able to, you know, you know, ward off this virus, then it will be a, it can be a wonder drug. Then say if you, I told you about the grains. The grains, they are very rich source of polyphenols, phenolic acids. They are present in the grains in plenty. And basically, if you see in United States, 35% of death, they are due to cancer. And they are basically related to diet. The diet is related to the cancer, and out of the, you know, all cancerous death, 35% of the death, they are related to diet. So consumption of grains, vegetables and fruits, that may prevent many diseases and promote good health. Grains, they are major source of antioxidants in our diet. As I told you, the main antioxidative component in grains, they are phenolic compounds. I have already told you. So this this was another important research which we carried out. I had a project from the University Grant Commission. We worked on, you know, pearl millet. I think in this part of Haryana where I am sitting, particularly in Sirsa, Hisar, lot of people, they are consuming you know, bajra. Okay. That is pearl millet. So pearl millet is a very important and rich source of antioxidants. It is very rich source of antioxidants. But as we analyzed, the antioxidant potential of the bioactive compounds which were present in this bajra or pearl millet, they were bound. And as we consume these you know, that bajra, raw bajra, or, you know, in any form, the, you know, anticipated benefit of the bajra or the antioxidant is not received by our body. The antioxidant, the compounds, phenolic compounds, they remain bound and they are not absorbed by our body. So we thought that how we can, you know, increase its you know, absorption, how the absorption into our body of these, you know, antioxidants can be increased. One method was that we can release these phenolic compounds by enzymatic mechanism. We can use hydrolytic enzymes, certain hydrolytic enzymes, and then release these phenolic compounds. And the other method, which was quite cheap, was use of the solid state fermentation. So we choose the second option, and we carried out solid state fermentation of bajra. And this bajra then you know, was fermented with certain filamentous fungi. We procured grass fungi. Grass means the which is generally recognized as safe. So that is known as grass. That is the full form. So these fungi we used, and we fermented bajra for up to 10 days. You can see the pictures. There is a control, then 2 days fermented, then 4 days fermented meal, then 6 days fermented meal, 8 days, 10 days fermented meal. And then we analyzed its, you know, antioxidative and polyphenolic capacity. So it was very important to note that in control, we had only, you know, around 18 milligrams of the polyphenols, phenolic content, total phenolic contents. Whereas on eighth day of fermentation, it was increased from 18 to almost 88. There was, you know, almost, you know, fivefold increase in the total phenolic content. And then, so when the total phenolic content increased, then we analyzed its, you know, antioxidant capacity. So antioxidant capacity was also, you know, remarkably increased after 8 days of fermentation of the you know, bajra with the filamentous fungi. We used Aspergillus oryzae, we used Rhizopus, certain species. Then we, you know, tested it. We tested antioxidant activity by using various methods. We used the DPPH method, we used ABTS method, we used HFRSA method, cupric acid method, TAC, RPA, etc. And in each case, you can see that if you see here, it is in control, it is 6, and after 10 days, it is 18. So almost threefold increase in the, you know, total phenolic content. Then the antioxidant capacity was also increased from 88 to 92. Okay. Then we also analyzed its DNA repair capacity, which was very important, which was very interesting. If you see these lanes, these are the lanes of DNA. DNA was run. So it is important to note lane 1, 2, 3, and 7. In lane 1, there is, you know, a very bright band of DNA. It is the native DNA. In lane 2, there is no band. So in this lane, what we did, we, you know, degenerated the DNA using Fenton reagent. Fenton reagent completely degenerate the DNA. In third, we used Fenton reagent, quercetin, and the DNA, right? So quercetin basically is a protective agent which can protect the damaging effect of the Fenton reagent. But now you see the seventh lane. In seventh lane, you will find that we used only DNA and the Fenton reagent. Fenton reagent that was, you know, damaging the DNA. So DNA, Fenton reagent plus the extract which we took from 4 days fermented bajra. We took the, you know, extract of that. So here you can see there is a, you know, very sharp band of DNA. That means it shows that the DNA is, you know, remarkably protected. There is a remarkable protection against Fenton reagent. Fenton is, you know, damaging the DNA. But this, you know, extract of the Pusa 415 variety of the bajra that protected this DNA very, you know, it protected, you know, up to, you know, 90%. So there are different food grains which are fermented with microorganisms. I will just go through these slides. There are food grains, they are available. Fermented food grains are available. Like you have polished rice, rice kozi is there, soybean kozi, then black bean kozi, rice kozi. All these, food, all these grains and legumes, cereals and legumes, they are, you know, fermented with, they can be fermented with the filamentous microorganisms, and they can give you, you know, better health, you know, promoting health promoting effect. So you have natto. This is fermented soybean. It is eaten with rice. It is prepared with Bacillus subtilis bacterium. This is Aspergillus oryzae growing on rice to make the kozi. this is our own research. This was Thamnidium elegans growing on maize. These are the maize grains, and Thamnidium is growing on this. And we prepared maize cozy, and this maize cozy is, you know, very, you know, protective against the, you know, damaging effects of the DNA, or damaging effect of these free radicals, basically. Now, we have discussed all this. Now, why we are interested in nutraceuticals? Why the nutraceuticals, they are so important? They are important for our health, particularly therapeutic. They have therapeutic functions, and the therapeutic functions of nutraceutical foods, they include cardiovascular health, cancer risk reduction, joint health, diabetes, weight management, respiratory health, mental health, immune system, skin health, gut health, maternal and infant health, eye health. So all these therapeutic benefit we can get from the nutraceuticals. So there is a, you know, rapid emergence of the nutraceutical market. Nutraceutical are, you know, available in plenty, and there is a, you know, great scope of the nutraceuticals all over the world. And why there is a rapid emergence of these nutraceuticals? Because they are able to, you know, ward off certain chronic diseases, which are, you know, major cause of mortality all over the world. Chronic diseases, they are increasing. Similarly, the aged population is growing. So when the aged population is growing, as I told you that some of the, you know, developed countries, they have more aged population, and they are, you know, consuming a lot of nutraceuticals. Similarly, you have positive perception for natural products. When you go to market, you ask for herbal products. You ask for, you know, something which is, you know, obtained from plants, from plant world. So there is a positive perception for natural products. So focus on preventive health is there. These days we are, you know, more focusing more, particularly in the era of COVID. We are focusing on, you know, healthcare, preventive healthcare. And there is increasing drug cost. So synthetic drugs, they are increasing. If we are able to protect ourselves from diseases, then we are, you know, we will not be spending much on the drugs, right? So it is there. So as far as the nutraceutical market is concerned, you can see in United States, there is a total $42 billion market is there. Dietary supplements account for $20 billion, functional food account for $22 billion, and there is a total consumption per capita. A per capita consumption of nutraceutical is $136 per year in United States. Similarly, if you see in Japan, the per capita consumption is very high. It is $166 per year a person is, you know, spending on nutraceuticals. Similarly, in Europe also, consumption per capita is around $92. I don't have data for you know, India, as we are, you know, just looking for this market now. So despite the foreign origin of the word nutraceutical, what it entails is indigenous to India, and India has a very rich heritage of herbal medicine. The Indian system of medicine is very old. Herbal system medicine is very old, and the supplements, they are available, and this can, you know, found resonance in our mythology also and in our folklore. The growth of nutraceuticals, particularly food and drink items which have, you know, nutraceutical benefit, which have health benefit, that can be seen largely in the modern days consumer lifestyle. as far as the production is concerned, in India, nutraceuticals market is there, and it is growing. In 2017, it was projected around $4 billion, and it is bound to increase in the era of COVID. It is bound to increase by $10 billion by 2022. So it is, you can see in the coming days, you will find that lot of nutraceuticals will be available. So some of my suggestions are, those who are smoking, please stop smoking. By cutting smoking, each breath takes in 10 to raise power 14 fewer free radicals. If you are smoking, you will be, you know, taking 10 to raise power 14 free radicals in your body. That will, you know, damage your health and your immunity. That will reduce your immunity. Then eat more and more fruits and vegetables, particularly when I told you in the very beginning that brightly colored fruits and the vegetables. I have seen in some of the farmers, they are growing like red cabbage, blue cabbage, so all such kind of vegetables, brightly colored vegetables, they contain lot of phenolic compounds. They are rich source of phenolic compounds, and as I told you that these phenolic compounds, they are the antioxidants. Then you can have some, green tea. Green tea is again a rich source of phenolic compounds. So to support your immune system all year round, what you should do, although I don't know whether we will be even, I am able to, follow these steps or not, but we should, fill our diet with 5 to 7 antioxidant rich fruits and vegetables every day. So that is my suggestions. One should follow, and because of taking of these antioxidants, if our immune system is strong, then we will be able to ward off the COVID disease. We will be able to overcome this disease. And if we have compromised immunity, even if we have compromised immunity and we start taking these antioxidants or antioxidant rich fruits and vegetables, then we can increase our immunity to a remarkable level. So with this, I thank you very much for patiently hearing me, and I thank all the organizers, and if there is any question, please, you can ask me any question. Vivek.
Thank you, Dr. Salar, for the very, very nice presentation. And I request Dr. Chavi Mangla, the organizing secretary of this webinar and in charge of the Life Science Association, to take the question answer session. Dr. Chavi Mangla, please. That's a, please screen share up, please burn kar de aap apna, please.
Okay. I think it is closed down.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes, please.
Good evening, everyone. It is my distinct honor and privilege indeed to extend my sincere thanks to our worthy speaker, Professor R.K. Salar, for delivering a wonderful talk on a very important topic. In this pandemic era, when everyone is trying to cope with coronavirus, people are turning more towards traditional ways to protect themselves from this deadly virus. knowingly or unknowingly, somehow they are taking up antioxidants from kadha, citrus fruits, etc. But if people know exactly how they can incorporate antioxidants in their diets, technically, they would be able to have a better immune system, which will not only be beneficial in protecting them from this coronavirus, but also from other diseases. Though this should be a routine, people are not much aware about it. In this direction, you very effectively sensitized us about the immunomodulatory effects of antioxidants in combating this COVID-19. You introduced us with the term nutraceuticals very nicely and how this could be beneficial in protecting the immunity of body. In a very effective manner, you explained how different types of antioxidants protect us from the deleterious effects of free radicals and which food items could be beneficial in this direction. So thank you very much, sir, for sharing this information.
My pleasure.
So we have received a few questions from the side of participants, which I would like to ask you.
Sure.
The first question is, it is said that with time, this coronavirus is going to weaken. Is it true?
Yeah, sure. Because as a student of science and as a microbiologist, the coronavirus, its multiplication rate is very high. And at every multiplication cycle, there is a chances of mutation.
Uh-huh.
And these mutations, 99% of the mutations, they are weakened mutations, and the virulence of the virus get diminished. But there is, some, 0.1% chances are there that there may be some, lethal mutation may be there. It may become more effective and more severe. It may also become, but there are chances, 99% chances are there that due to passage of time, the virus may weaken over the time. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. This could be a good news to the audience. Another question is, what type of diet should be preferred during these days, especially for the children?
Thank you. I have already told you that we should include all, colored vegetables, the colored fruits. Particularly, say like you have blueberries, they are rich source of antioxidants, and we should take I think you have tulsi or you have vidania leaves or tulsi leaves. You can just boil these tulsi leaves or vidania, and you can have that water. So this contain lot of antioxidants, and as I told you that antioxidants, they are warding off all free radicals. Although the children, they have younger children, they have low immunity, but the person who are from the age of 15 and above, right? So they have strong immunity, and there is very little chances of getting them infection.
Thank you, sir. One last question. Do citrus pickles and amla candies help in boosting immunity?
Yes, sure. Because all citrus fruits, whether it is in the form of rot fruit or in the form of pickles. I told you that pickle, formation of pickle is a fermentation process, right? So the fermentation also further increases the availability of the antioxidants. It makes the polyphenols more concentrated in that form. So if you consume pickles of citrus or whatever, all right, so whatever the form is there, so citrus fruit is very good in
Thank
whatever
you, sir,
form.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Answering all the queries. Sir, we are delighted to share with you that today we have participants from different parts of India, almost 17 states.
Okay, okay. 17 states.
Punjab, J&K, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, etc.
Okay, thank you.
It is definitely a proud moment for us and for you as well. Sir, I again thank you wholeheartedly on behalf of Life Science Association and all the members of Organizing Committee, DN College, Hisar. And now I would like to invite our Principal Sir, Dr. Vikramjit Singh, to give a vote of thanks to our college speaker.
Good evening to all. I'm extremely thankful, Dr. R.K. Salar, Dean Life Sciences, Chaudhary Devi Lal University, Sirsa, for a wonderful presentation. Sir, your presentation was very informative, very enriching for a person like me, who is a student of political science. You started, your lecture was very systematic and comprehensive. Sir, you started with the defining the immunity. What is immunity? The types of immunity, genetic immunity and adaptive immunity, how the immunity can be compromised, is compromised, what is the immunodeficiency, role of oxygen in our life. And sir, you also told how the cigarette smoking, alcohol consumption, radiations, environmental pollution, synthetic drugs can reduce our immunity. Sir, in the second part, you defined what is the coronavirus, how the coronavirus spread, how we can combat with the coronavirus. There may be pharmaceutical intervention, there may be non-pharmaceutical interventions, immunomodulation. And in the last part, sir, you beautifully explained how antioxidants will enhance our immunity. Sir, it was very, very enriching, informative, systematic, comprehensive presentation. We are very much thankful to you. I'm thankful to all the participants. I'm thankful to the organizing committee, Dr. Vivek Srivastav, the convener, Dr. Aditya, Dr. Hemant, co-conveners, and Dr. Chavi Mangla, organizing secretary. I'm thankful to all. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vikram. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I take this opportunity to thank our respected principal, sir, for his valuable cooperation in organizing this webinar. And I also extend my thanks to my team members, Dr. Vivek Srivastavan, convener of the webinar, Dr. Aditya Kumar, and Dr. Hemant Sharma, co-conveners of the webinar, and all the members of organizing committee. A special thanks to our technical team, Mr. Manoj Bindal, Madam Urvashi, and Shri Sushil Rajpal for all their efforts. I also thank all the participants associated with us for making this event purposeful. Again, thank you, sir, for gracing the session. It was great having you with us. Thank you, everyone. Have a nice evening.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.